project.
Smart road section for downtown. We are hoping to give a presentation for about 30 minutes and then convene back in this format that we are right now. Spend a few minutes digesting what comes out of the presentation. And after those 10, 15 minutes, I'm going to bring you together to answer some of the questions for today. My name is George Katsoulis, and I used to be an associate member of the planning board. That's an empty seat. Please step right up and volunteer to Julie after this meeting. The purpose of today's meeting is, at a very high level, to connect the goals of the town under two documents that I will show you in the coming slides with our downtown zoning, to discuss the economic development as this has been manifesting in these documents and in several meetings that we have had ever since we started discussing a new thinking about how the downtown should look. To consider other zoning mechanisms besides the 40R district that is an overlay on top of our business district in downtown, and to listen to your concerns, gather feedback, and hopefully answer some questions at the end of the day. So the first test, who knows when zoning was enacted in Reading? What is the year? Yes, sir?
1942.
A plus, exactly. Since that time, our town fathers decided that the downtown, or a portion of the downtown, as it existed at that time, was going to be labeled under a business regulation set of rules. Several years later, in 2005, we concluded our master plan. How many of you have participated in the 2005 master plan? Just show hands. Okay. A little bit less than half. So I welcome you back. We're going to be discussing some of the things we discussed at that time for the first time. These are some of the high-level goals that were established as part of this process, which lasted about, I believe, a year, year and a half, Jonathan, if I'm not mistaken. It was almost as painful as the zoning reform update we did about last year. It's right here. It's an economic development goal. In a manner of speaking, it is indirectly related to housing goal 2 and housing goal 3, to promote variety. The Economic Development Action Plan, I believe a few months ago, we were right here with MAPC discussing some of the areas that we will discuss today. How many of you were in that meeting, more or less? Okay, so there are many new faces here that please ask questions if some of the concepts are need more specifics. There were a few strategies that were developed as part of the Economic Development Action Plan. One of those, Strategy 1A, to expand. To expand the downtown smart growth district, you're going to see that a lot, DSGD, to other acronyms. I hate acronyms. Priority development areas. Essentially illustrating the other half of the downtown that is not covered by our 40R. The zoning map, which is fairly easy for everyone to see right here, illustrates a triangle, a green triangle in the middle, which is our business speed district. Half of it is overlaid by our 40R district, a smart growth zoning district, which is, as I say, it's an option. It is not mandatory or required in any manner. It's an option for those who choose to pursue building upgrades or permitting of any sort under this. There was another area, if you remember, right here. Oops. Which we're not discussing today, strategy 1B, to look at South Main Street. That will be another meeting in a few months that we have to prepare again for weeks and weeks to come. But just keep it in the back of your heads that this is coming to the South Main Street. Right?
How far South Main Street
is it? Whenever we discussed South Main Street 2 and 3 years ago, if I remember correct, it starts at a train crossing and goes down to South Street.
Oh.
And there are about 3 segments, I believe.
Three or four
segments that are interrupted by housing. Okay, so let's look at what we have today. We have a smart growth zoning district, which is about 50% of the business fee, and of which 54 properties are surrounded, that are inside that district. 50% are single-story buildings. So, and a question about single-story buildings in a business district. We called it, during the master plan process, we called it unrealized potential. The unrealized potential of the downtown. So, would someone care to say what they understand by this? Okay, to sustain town business?
Just go up.
Go up, like increasing height?
Tenants in the building.
All right, how about the type of business? Okay.
More office space.
Although it's a little challenging these years with the internet era. When we started the 40R, we looked at three basic types of usages. The mixed use favors commercial uses on the at street level and residential uses above. That we call the mixed use way of using 4R. We have another type of use, which is only residential. And it was intentional when we initiated the 4R to look at some areas that do not favor commercial functions on the first floor. If you can imagine some of the streets that are perpendicular to Haven Street, perhaps we wouldn't want businesses to basically permeate where there are more residential character on the street. So we had that option at that time for a little bit less density and less building, but still residential mixed use. And we had another speed of using this district, which is called reuse of existing, so that looking at buildings that are more than a story tall, and they do have today residential buildings above, is there a way to facilitate the owners in a manner that we can turn those to conforming type of parcel? The adaptive reuse hasn't caught up far yet. It hasn't been used in a manner that we have seen, but the language is still there to look at existing buildings and how they're used and how we can offer more options to the owners. So 40B regulates density and allows us by statute to present the applicant with design guidelines that they have to follow. Now, this is something important if projects are of medium to large size. We do care how buildings look like in the downtown. It may be a little bit less impactful if a smaller building is not developed according to those guidelines. So design guidelines for small projects like single lots or dual lots are not so much of an issue, at least in my opinion. Business B is still the underlying zoning, that's the base zoning. We started back in 42 and we have changed in one fashion or in one way or another. We have added to it, we have subtracted to it, but basically that's what is there. And Business B does not allow any type of residential use. So that's the shape underneath. That's that weird shape on top of the map. We will see it clear in the next slides. What we have done today was we have done some analysis to bring to you and prepare to show you five distinct areas that border the existing 40-yard district and discuss those. And we have looked at data from our public town GIS and from the assessor's data, which are public information. I'll be happy to show you if you don't know how to find it. It's basically a town type of information. It's not state or anything. It's information we have in our town website. And perhaps Julie, you can talk a little bit afterwards if someone is interested.
Absolutely.
All right. So these are the five areas that we will be discussing. Let's start with the first area. This is an area which is bordered by High Street and Sanborn on the east and west, and it's on the south side of Woburn. It's an area which is not included in the business fee. It's an area that is traversed by an arterial street, and typically arterial streets are a little bit more challenging when there are many driveways every few buildings. Those driveways are in conflict sometimes with traffic, and they actually may stop traffic. So it's not good to have narrow arterial streets and traffic on the driveways. What I'm trying to say is that intense developments on these kind of streets may not be as favorable from a traffic standpoint. As you can see, there are four properties on the state registry, which means that the state recognizes they are historically significant. And I took a look on what happens across that street on the north side. They're basically twice as many. So, for whatever that may mean to each one of us, that portion of Woburn Street seems to have like a historical significance, not only from a property and building standpoint, but also from a street standpoint. That it is a very unique piece of Woburn Street. If one considers Woburn Street coming, running from there, all the way from West Street up to downtown. It's a very, very unique portion, a very unique portion of Woburn Street. The next area that we analyzed was the Green Street area, which is bordered by Gould, Green, and Ash. It's an area with very few commercial uses. Almost, you can count them in the fingers of the hand. There are several small lots with small buildings which are two or three family, which allows us to make a hypothesis that there are several affordable units in that area that the town should be interested and concerned about them and how to maintain this diversity in the near and the long run. And the densities, if you were to calculate how dense is that area on a per acre basis, these numbers that you see here, this number and this number, is above where we set our threshold for 4-yard. Should I say that again?
Yeah.
That the densities today, as they are higher than what we allow for new projects in 4-yard. What would be the minimum we allow? Because we sometimes allow waivers to increase the density, but these are above the minimum. And I went to, this morning, I wanted to see, how old is this part of town? And if someone goes in a map that is published from 1873,
you'll see that this porch, this type of housing is still there. There are three houses here and about seven or eight back there in an 1873. So that's pretty old and pretty unique for our downtown to have this option, almost like a backyard to our Haven Street and our main street. The next area we looked at was the portion of Main Street, which is at the north from Haven up to Washington. And it's bordered by Ash Street and the first row, the parcels are basically about Main Street. What is unique in this area, in my opinion, is how the buildings begin to set back, not on the first block, but here, as you can see, there's parking up front. We begin to see the pattern of South Main Street being born here. The buildings are not close to the sidewalk. The uses are set back. There are cars between the sidewalk and the building, which brings to mind some other, you know, other type of, other, the buildings look different, the sites look different. If you compare that to how the block above M.F. Charles going up towards the Venetian Moon block looks like, all the buildings are very close to the street. It's a pedestrian-friendly character. So for us, a question to answer today is, do we want that to extend further south in this particular area? We also found out that a lot of these buildings on the east side of Main Street in this area are from the 1930s, so they're about, you know, more than 80 years old. And this tells us that they are, at some point, their life cycle is coming to an end. They will be prone for development or rebuild. So maybe the time is ripe to begin to look at this as a priority area. For the last, we also looked at the area of A40. A, I believe, is for
apartment
40. It is our most versatile way of looking at residential in town. It allows single family, it allows two family, and it allows multifamily. It's basically a district that is very flexible. The makeup, however, is single family. One would expect there are some two and three family and very few multi-family. So this is an area which is basically behind those buildings, behind Main Street to the east, but only a small portion of it basically touches on John Street. If you're familiar with John, runs down this way. So it's the area behind the blocks we were discussing before from the 1930s. And the densities that we have seen there are very comparable to minimum densities under 40R. And finally, is, as I understand, many people have come today for the fifth area to see what we can do about it. It's the west of the train tracks. So now for this part of the presentation, there will be no questions about 40B. Let's stick to the big picture. The big picture is, this is the most that we have ever thought of expanding 40R on this side of town. Like, even in the most ambitious plans we had, that was pre-recession in 2006 or 2007, that we thought that this was a good idea with all the opportunities that we saw around. So the area starts at the existing apartments that are at the end of Washington Street. It jogs around to Arlington, includes the area that we have discussed before, and it stops at a small triangular parcel which is between Washington and Lincoln. Again, this is the area that we looked at. What is unique about this area is a portion of the properties here are not through lots. They are not lots that have, here, in this area, there are lots that basically have a property line back here. So they're only facing Lincoln Street, as opposed to these lots that are full lots that face both streets. And there are, perhaps this is something to consider when we discuss the area. So this is my last slide, and Julie will pick up the rest of the presentation. So 40R is a state law. It started in, anybody knows when the first time we heard that term 40R? It's not the test. It's 2004, okay? Governor in 2004 passed this legislation and thought we're allowed to have an alternative to traditional zoning. Communities with 40R are eligible for a priority and incentives. The word has it that sometimes school projects may be favored or may go up the priority list if there is a 40R in town. I mean, I'm not sure this is true, but I've heard it a few times.
Do you mean a 40R project or a 40R district?
Towns with 40R districts may be more favorably looked by MSBA or other authorities that rank school projects or how they prioritize school projects. At least that was the strong feeling before this government. I don't know if it's still the truth. They're allowed by right, projects by right. And currently, and I conclude with that, in our 40R, we have language to allow only multifamily. That doesn't mean that this is the way we want to continue with some of the districts, but right now, we allow multifamily, a minimum density of 20 units per acre. So this would be probably medium to larger project size, like 30 Haven would be a large project for our area. But that's nothing to say that we cannot add to the existing bylaw we have, allowing two family or single family as long as they are in these densities. Now, if you remember, I showed a slide that on Green Street, this number is 13 already. So, something to consider. Lastly, we can define within our 40R sub-districts where some of these things apply and some do not. So there is flexibility in how we look at 40R. Some areas we may want multifamily, some other areas we may want both multi or single and two family mixed in. It's up to us to decide what we want.
So before I start my portion of the presentation, I'm very impressed by the turnout, and I think if I could have a couple of volunteers just help me bring some of the chairs that are up front here to the back so the newcomers can be a little more comfortable. So I'm Julie Mercier. I'm the new community development director for the town. I'm the new kid on the block, so any questions from things that happened before 4 months ago, I'm going to maybe punt to somebody else. I'll do my best in sort of trying to explain why we're here tonight. And George just talked a lot about the downtown smart growth district, and I'm going to sort of go back a step and say, you know, what is 40R and why are we considering alternatives to it tonight? The big reason we're here is because there's been some talk in town about expanding our existing downtown smart growth district into some of the neighboring areas seen on the maps in front of you. But before we decide that 40R is the silver bullet and that it's a solution that will work in all these areas, we wanted to broaden the discussion before we narrow it. So economic development is a big initiative in town right now, and there are a lot of zoning tools that exist that can get us there. But looking at new approaches is something that we want to consider. Other types of zoning would allow us maybe more flexibility in residential density, whereas George just mentioned The state requires 20-plus units per acre for a multifamily project and will allow any mixed-use projects as long as we meet those residential densities. The other aspect of that is that our current local 40R regulations say that not more than 50% of the gross floor area of any project can be devoted to other uses. So looking at alternative zoning mechanisms would give us a way to maybe change the balance. If we decide in an area we want fewer residential units and more commercial, you know, we have that opportunity. The other benefits to looking at alternative mechanisms are that we can keep the process at the local level. We don't necessarily have to go out to the state to get their approval for what we're doing. And then 40R projects are required to be allowed by right, and they're only subject to plan review, where alternative zoning would allow us to administer permitting through a special permit process. So we'd have more discretion at the town level. So there are a lot of alternative zoning mechanisms, and the state has a smart growth toolkit. And in that toolkit are a lot of different overlay districts, mixed use overlay, village center overlay, transit oriented development overlay. Those are just a few of them. And why are overlays important? Well, first of all, they protect the underlying zoning. They give property owners more opportunities for redevelopment, but they don't render the existing uses that are there non-conforming. They're also really good in areas where you have multiple underlying zoning districts. So you don't have to go in and change the mechanics of all those underlying zoning districts. You can say, okay, these are guidelines for long-term thinking and long-term planning in this broader area. But they don't render what's there now non-conforming. So these overlay districts, they kind of get at the same basic principles. Compact, walkable neighborhoods, diversity in the housing stock, maintaining neighborhood character, promoting sustainable use of land, linking uses to transit, and fulfilling existing housing, transportation, and economic development needs. So they're all getting at these smart growth principles. So the differences between these overlays are in the way that they're applied. And certain overlays are appropriate in certain places. So mixed use is a pretty commonly used overlay district. A lot of times it's used in downtown areas or areas that are in need of revitalization, areas where properties are starting to turn over and the town says, okay, I would love to step in and maybe sort of help shape how that area grows as the properties turn over. And they're also good in transition areas where you have a business zone and a residential zone and you need something that sort of meets both needs in the middle. Village center overlays are really good in traditional downtowns, where gradual or piecemeal redevelopment is likely because you have small lots and they don't all turn over at the same time, and it might be hard for someone to accumulate multiple parcels. And then transit-oriented development is typically most appropriate within a quarter to a half mile of a transit node. So there are pieces in all of these overlays that could be applicable to Reading. I mean, we have all of these situations here. So what I wanted to get at tonight was that we have sort of this buffet that we can choose from. We don't have to say we want this type of overlay in this area. We can say let's create our own overlay and let's look at the nuts and bolts of what would be involved in that. So if we were to create our own overlay district, these are the kinds of things that we would look at. We would start by saying, what is our intention for this area? What is the vision? And that's part of why we're here tonight. We want to hear from you. What do you think of the areas that we're looking at? What types of uses do you think are appropriate there? And in implementing the intent and the vision, a lot of it boils down to what uses are allowed. And in a mixed-use area, you want to kind of tailor the use to work well together, to establish those connectivities. Then you look at dimensional regulations. These are really important. They really impact the pedestrian human scale of an area. How big of a tract do we want to allow to be developed? It's good to have a range, especially in areas where you have small lots and large lots. And then looking at buildings, what kind of heights do we want? Do we want to limit the floor area ratio. Then you look at parking provisions. In certain areas, you might allow reduced parking requirements if they're close to the train, or you might allow shared parking arrangements for uses that have different peak hours. Design standards. These are other things that we can add into an overlay district. We can say, what do we think this site layout should look like? How do we want buildings to be oriented to each other? Do we want, you know, pedestrian paths through sites? What kind of landscaping do we like? And then with buildings, how do we want the fenestrations to meet the public? How do we want people to perceive these, the space that they're in? You can look at streetscapes, signage. These are all things that we can work on at the local level, creating an overlay district. And then there's the bonus sort of incentive provision that's usually involved, and it ties directly to the intent and the vision that we have for the district. So if we're trying to promote affordable housing, we might give a developer a density bonus if they use more affordable housing. If we want more civic uses or more open space, we might say, okay, you can put more units on this site because you've given us this 40% open space. I mean, these are the kind of things you want to have regulations that developers will use that aren't too onerous, but you also want to maintain control. And that's getting to the last piece. Like I mentioned before, these overlay districts can be administered through a special permit process, which is discretionary. It's a conversation between the permit granting authority and the developer. So a lot of these things can get worked out in that process. Okay, so expanding the 40R district might be the right idea. It's a great tool. We have it in town. Some great projects have been developed. But we're here tonight to get your feedback on the areas that we have on these maps. So this is the fun part. We're going to play a little with these maps we have and all the tools, the pens, the dots, the stickies. So hopefully you're all game for this. But we have four main questions. The first question is, of the five areas, which do you think we should prioritize? And on the table, you have a big map, and you have big dots, big red, green, and blue dots.
Julie, is it possible to get this light turned on? We're kind of in the dark.
Yourselves with a little extra time, or if you want to just wait till the end, because we do really want your input on all the questions, but we want to keep moving as well. So the second question is, which uses are appropriate in your mind in each area? And we have this one, we have small maps, and we have the small dots. And the small dots are labeled, the red dots are labeled R for residential, the blue dots are labeled B for business, and the yellow dots are labeled M for mixed. If you'll just look at each of the five smaller maps and put, you can use as many dots as you want to let us know what types of uses you think are appropriate in each area.
Is green open space, you said?
Green could be open space. I didn't label it.
Congratulations.
But not all of the area. Please keep that because there will be a Q&A session right now. If you think that a part of the area is favorable for the red dot, the blue dot, or the green dot, and not the whole area, please ask the question so that we know how you feel about the part of the area.
About any of these proposals, about specifics within each of the zones that we're looking at.
We do have more questions that we will be asking, more stickers. But let's just take a quick break, and if you have any questions, just start firing up at us, and we'll do our best to address them.
Debbie Harris from Green Street. And I'm in the one, number one, but that part doesn't, that has to be.
Just in general, bringing
all this extra housing, I understand that we're supposed to, for regulations and everything, there is no more room for cars in this town. And I'm dead, it took me 15 minutes to get out of Columbus the other day. Ridiculous. Is there anything else that you've done? You can't widen Main Street, you can't. And you know, and the parking, you know, you talk about the parking, there isn't a whole lot of parking left in this town.
Yeah. We've heard that feedback from my
driveway just so they could go to the train.
Absolutely. And I think some of the goals here is to kind of promote pedestrian walkways integrated in the town through bike paths and things like that. But I agree. I know the Board of Selectmen, I believe that they've started to look at parks because they really own a lot of that. So there's some work going on trying to figure out, because it's a big problem right now. Absolutely. This, you're right, it seems like there's a little bit of confidence. We're trying to encourage growth, we're trying to get more people in town, trying to get more business in town, at the same time we're dealing with probably a parking crisis.
Parking is one of the strategies recommended in the Economic Development Action Plan that they look at as a comprehensive
years ago about this town. It was called City of Trees or something, which this town is no longer that. Because of all the building that's gone on, you don't have, the charm is gone.
I think it'll be more about managing the parking supply that we do have a little bit better so that parking spaces open up more frequently and so that people are aware of where the parking is and how to get to it. Because that is some of the problem. It's not the entirety of the problem, but Reading is in a tough spot because you can't really live here and not own a car. And a lot of people want to live here because the school systems are good, amenities. But it's really in that tricky, you know, it's not Cambridge where you can live and not have a car, and it's not fully suburban or rural. It's really kind of in the middle.
But the town has already added spaces on the private roads. Mm-hmm. I live on Gold Street, and they made so many more spaces. And when they redid that area, they made a big emphasis on adding spaces. And I'm thinking that we've caught up by adding more spaces, but the more spaces you add, the more difficult it is to find more when you go to the
city. Right.
Yeah. So when you, I'm Jim Queenie, I live on Mount Vernon, the Bancroft. So when you do, have the people move into these new apartments or whatever, I think when we did the Atlantic, it was 1.25 cars. I mean, allocate more spaces. I mean, give the neighborhood a break. And give the people that own houses now a right to park in front of their own houses and or build a garage. I mean, I second the motion. I mean, parking is a priority that you should do. People should have the right to park in front of their own house.
Thank you.
And maximize that for 1.25, crazy.
Do you have a high-level vision of Marianne Downing, 1300, or what you want this town to look like? We have all these little pockets. Is there another town that's doing it right? You'd say, oh, we should look like Andover, or we should look like, you know, this part of the community. Is anybody doing it in a way that so we know what you're trying to strive for at a high level? Because it's hard. I mean, there's some areas you want more residential, commercial. What do we want Reading to be? What do you guys have a vision?
See my partner, John
Weston, CBDC. I think that's exactly why we're here, is that this town is pretty diverse. And, you know, as George said, that was 10 years ago when we had went through the master plan process. That was a long time ago. A lot of things have changed. The economy has changed. A lot of development has happened. We're at another place where we should be examining where do we want to go from here. What what we're trying to do is, where do we want the downtown to go from where it is? And trying to get, you know, input from you all, because, you know, I have in my mind what I think should happen, but that's just one person. So the more things that we have like this, I'm not sure that there will be a singular vision, but even through the discussion right here at this table, there's some things that have bubbled up that say, well, sounds like we don't want to go that direction, or maybe we want to go that direction. But I certainly wouldn't want us to say, oh, I think we should grow up like Concord or Peabody or pick another town because Reading's Reading and should stay.
Dennis Durante, 32 Green Street. I think, and maybe this is just off the cuff, but as far as businesses in Reading, I think we have to be more diversified about the type of businesses that we have in Reading. For instance, right now, I know we got 20,000 sub shops, we got 50,000 hairdressers. Huh?
The nail salons.
The nail salons, you name it. I think that we have to have some diversity as far as what business we want to drive. I think we really have to go out, and I discussed this with you, and get those businesses here. I mean, they're just not going to come. You've got to grab
them. Hi, Sexton, I'm on the Board of Selectmen. I want to just address that exactly. So in our next budget, we put in place an economic development plan. This is going to be a new position that we're going to have in town. That person's role is going to be specifically what you're talking about, going out and working with commercial businesses to try to see what, you know, what can we do to attract here at Reddit to have a bigger kind of more businesses come to town. So we're trying to take that step right now in our next budget with this new position, and we're real hopeful that with everything going on in a group like this and tonight, that we can really make it more attractive community for diverse businesses, and not just the smaller ones, certainly that are, you know, on every little corner that we have in the downtown area now.
Joy School,
thank you.
Well said.
on the opposite where it says Vine Street. There's a big, that's a big brick building. That's the condos there, Briarwood, I think, right? The area behind that is shaded in. Years ago, my wife and I bought a condo there, and we were told that that area was all conservation land. Is that conservation land? Or? Because if it is, I'm wondering why it's in a shaded area.
We have a whole parcel, some of a portion of that parcel is not buildable, so do not, this is a misunderstanding. Maybe unbuildable land just happens to be inside the parcel. So nothing has changed in that area. Conservation.
Well, that was my question. Is it conservation land or is it? Yeah, because if it is, it probably shouldn't be in the shaded area.
In our blue shaded area?
Right.
Yeah, these are just general like areas that we outlined to start the discussion. They're not necessarily going to be what we end up with if we look at these areas. And it could be that the entire parcel has some conservation lands and some developable area. And usually, from a zoning standpoint, it's good to include the whole parcel when you rezone an area so that you're not split zoning it. So we would include maybe the whole parcel, even if pieces of it are wetlands.
Parcels like that also, Mexicana, parcels like that also offer opportunity to develop if they're not in the water. So build buildable.
Comments, questions? Sir.
I have a more solution-oriented comment on the parking. Nate Chesley, Fulton Street. Two points. If one, is it possible when you're talking about high-density residential to put the burden of parking on the developer? I don't think it's feasible economically to do underground parking in some of these cases, but that's one option. And the second option I would think about is if the density in the smart growth district is planned with a vision towards walkability, amenities in town, grocery stores, farmers stands, things like this, you might actually reduce the number of cars that you need if new residential goes in. So I see the two being very inextricably linked when you think about new residential and new retail.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Mary
Sewell
from High Street. Saturday night, I just wanted to get, I was driving. I couldn't, ordinarily I could probably walk down to shop, but I was out driving. There was no way I could park anywhere. In front, I circled the block from CVS back, not even one single spot, all the way down Haven, either side, to the Masonic Temple, around the block again in front of CVS, all the way down Main Street, as far as the gas station. On both sides. Finally, I just turned into a little place, a little business center, that's it. I'm getting out here and get that piece. But there wasn't there was one woman, she had to get to CVS. I don't know where she finally found me, and she just was walking and walking, because she couldn't get into CVS. And that's, and it's a red, I know, and it was, I put the reasons on. But that's, and it was early, and there's a good-sized retail business that, I mean, and has medical issues. And there was no way for any valid spots even for, say, an emergency. And never mind pizza. But, I mean, and that was going, and I spent about 15 minutes.
Yeah.
I'm very angry with myself at that point. And I said, wait, maybe I'll just go home and tell my good get pizza.
Yeah, no,
it's really all the wishful thinking for places that need a piece of land to put the places on.
Yeah, we want businesses, but we're here. We hear you. Absolutely, hear the fact that there's a lot of concerns about the lack of parking in this town.
Businesses, yep. Then they when they come downtown, I can walk 2 hours to Lemon, or some of the other jobs, 2.5 hours worth of shopping in town, do some shopping, supply.
Right.
And they all can't walk.
Right, right.
I like the walk, but I mean, it's my
appreciate that. Thank you. Yeah. In the back, yes, sir.
Peter's Sweetser Street. Well, I just want to make a sort of a comment. I'm new to town, but I just want to make a comment about sort of the Haven Street area and the smart growth, and to sort of compare. Again, I'm in Sweetser, so over by Tavern. And, you compare the new development along in the smart growth area on Haven Street and just how it feels in terms of being able to walk to the stores, and you compare that to South Main Street, where it's all businesses, and it's just, South Main Street is just so forbidding, and so it's just sort of this area. And so just, I would really love if you could make it so that you had more of the Haven Street feel on South Main Street. And I know, that's the things that we're talking about here, where you're putting zoning stuff in place where you can make, you know, we're not talking just making it possible for something like that to happen.
So that's good. Let's try to, maybe I can turn that into a question. I mean, what is your vision? What do we want Reading to look like? How do we want it to shape up? Yeah, Jay.
Jay Plex, Center Ave. I just echo the comment. On Center Ave, not too far from Sweetser, Haven Street, I feel, has been a totally rejuvenated area for those of us who live near the community real stock. There are some good shops. Yeah, there's a couple of smaller ones that have kind of gone out, new ones come in, but the vast majority of the area is much more lively. I mean, I lived here when Atlantic was here, and it was a nice local shop, but that kind of time has passed. And I think one of the problems that we're running into is that Reading is becoming slightly more urban in terms of its population amount, but we can't keep burdening residents with the sole tax burdens to deal with all the amenities that we want to have. You talked about the great schools. They're not going to be great if we can't keep paying for them. And the schools are bursting at the seams with kids. So I think it's imperative upon us to kind of develop something along those lines where you can have people come in, but you can also have businesses to share that burden financially for all of us to still enjoy the town, still have somewhat of a clean field, but realize that, you know, we're not the Reading of 1940 or 50 anymore, and we don't want to be kind of a downtown Somerville or Medford either. We have to find that kind of middle ground, so I think these mixed use parcels have that potential.
Sir?
Just a couple of comments. With regards to the rezoning aspect, I think one thing that is important to recognize is that if we explore different zoning options, it may actually allow us to redevelop some sites right now, taking up spaces maybe along the streets and whatnot. So you could actually see that increase of parking spots available, where people could actually redevelop their site and require parking spaces be developed on their site. So for me, a rezoning component really is value. Fully sympathetic, all the residents are really against, you know, right against the business district. They're the one staged right now with that overflow parking. So you could see a situation where somebody is, you know, their footprint is their entire parcel of land right now, their building. They may say, you know something, I would love to see townhouses here or some other type of option and parking spaces on that site. Therefore, taking the people that are now right now in your overflow parking going into the residential zones, kind of pulling those folks back.
Thank you. Matt?
Edna from Arlington Street. What about the parking lot behind CVS, Reading Co-op? I think that's a big space that's really not used wisely. I mean, we have spots and they're always
all the
full.
That's what our problem is.
That's what I'm saying. It's always full. But what if you build up? Put a parking garage.
Who's going to build up?
Bring, well, whatever business comes.
Well, who owns the land, the parking lot? Does it
town? Town lot?
Yeah. So the town, I mean, we could put a parking garage there, I guess. Maybe. I mean, that would solve a lot of the problems. And you already have a big lot that's just a parking anyway.
That's always full.
Yeah, it's always full.
Sit there for hours.
And it kind of makes sense to just put a garage there. Double or triple the parking.
It's just, that's big money, right? That's huge money.
Are they getting revenue?
I'm sorry?
Could they get revenue?
Yeah. So I think, I mean, I think that that aspect, I mean, honestly, I've heard that. I think that's a good idea. I've heard that before. My neighbor brings it up all the time. I think it's got to be part of that strategy around parking, that whole conversation. And that could be an element that's considered. I know it's been discussed. I just think it is a lot of money. But you're right. There could be some cost benefit to that as well.
I'm looking at that right now in Woburn. I'm president of the city council in Woburn, and we're considering doing a parking drive downtown. And the number is just, it's right when you think about spending that type of money in a parking garage. And a lot of times, as everybody knows, residents, you know, we all want to invest in our schools, our public safety. So we start to talk about parking garages, and unfortunately, a lot of times, they have to park at the lower level. For me, we were looking at about 300 spaces, and we were looking to $10, $12 million. So for us, that was about $1 million a year in debt service. We're probably only going to generate about $250,000. So we're looking at a $750,000 number to come up with every year in order to create those 300 spaces. Now, maybe there's new tax revenue that can be generated by the redevelopment that might occur around that parking lot. But certainly, the number, when somebody like Kevin's position, making that determination, where do I spend the dollars, where does parking fall relative to schools, public safety, and all the other important areas we all care about.
If I can remind everyone, about 4 years ago, we hired a consultant who did the parking utilization study. I don't know if anyone remembers that.
Yes.
Does anyone remember the finding of that study?
Yeah. They said we had
less. But why? Parking. Why?
No net need at that point.
Well, you look at the unused, unfortunately, that residential house that was taken down on Sanborn Street, Mariana O'Neill, that Reading Cooperative bought, tore down, built a parking lot, and there's like three or four cars in there now. It's just totally empty. We need to take advantage of some of the existing opportunities.
Thank you, everyone. I think, are you all ready to get on to the last couple of questions that we have, since we're not here all night? So, and like I said, if you didn't finish the first two, you can always come back. We're not going to kick the odds from the beginning. So, actually, that's question four.
Oh.
You're always like ahead of the curve. So. Question three actually requires you guys to look at the boards at the back of the room. And I know some of you had the chance when you first came in. This might take some time. It might take some coordination. Maybe like one or two tables can go up, and the other tables can continue working on one and two. If you'll just look at, we've identified some specific zoning options for each area, and there's stickers at the back by the posters. They're yellow dots, and they say wire end. We just want some very general feedback about what you think of these ideas. Like, if you read it and you're like, no way, slap an N on it.
So to reassure everybody, one of the options is no change.
So if maybe if you want to start the tables in the back of the room, if you want to just start. Okay, so question three requires you to go to the board. Question four, you can stay where you are and use the post-its, small post-its and big post-its. We want to get more specific feedback from you that you might have. If something comes to mind about a specific area, write it on a sticky and put it on the big map.
Where's the big map?
Planning and Development Commission to digest, get through, do the public outreach, hold public hearings, and sort of vet through the town process before it goes to town meeting. So really, we're not sure at this point whether there will be something at town meeting. We really need to see what you told us tonight before we can make that determination. And then whatever it is that we decide to go with, if there is something, there will be plenty more public meetings, a lot more public outreach. There'll be a lot more opportunities for feedback. You will be hearing from us, and you will be hearing about it. So I just want to thank you all for coming. Yeah, so all of the materials from tonight and the presentation will be posted on the website on the Community Planning and Development Commission page on the town's
website.
Yes. So I'll put that up there tomorrow. So you can
all this material take us 2 months to combine, so.
No, I can put up the raw versions of everything, yeah, but then the actual, like, digested, accumulated feedback will be a little more time coming.
How does one notify the next meetings are?
The easiest way to keep track of when the Community Planning and Development Commission is meeting and when they're discussing zoning is to go to the town's website, which is www.ma.gov, and click on the e-subscribe button at the top of the page and sign up to receive the agendas. That's the easiest way to always know what's going on. And you can sign up for multiple board agendas. You don't just have to sign up for CPDC.
I suppose you get some regular tape because I think these stickies are going to come off.
Oh, I have tape.
We need to process them, but take pictures.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you.
Jeff.